Good afternoon, Dame Kate and Martin Wall. I gather Christopher Walker is stuck in security. So if we feel we ought to make a start, and he can, I'm sure, will catch up very quickly. Well, this is the first hearing of our inquiry into housing. We very much focused on, as you will have seen from the call for evidence, on the supply of affordable housing, both for the social sector and also for the first-time buyer sector. So that is the remit that we've, and that is the focus of this inquiry. I wonder if I can just start off by asking both of you about the likely number of homes, the number of homes that we should be targeting over the next 5 years. Now, the housing minister, he said he wants 1 million new homes. There are other numbers that have been bandied about on previous occasions, and the Chancellor had some comments last week about the number of homes. What, in your view, is the target that we should be looking at, and why? Would you like to start, Dame Kate?
It's, I will, but do stop me if I go on for too long. I think the first thing I'd say when you're asking what the target you're looking at and why is, what is your policy objective really here? Now, I guess most people would say that their policy objective is for everybody to have a decent home of some standard, and in previous governments, added to that, they said in a place where they would like to live and work, which is quite ambitious because lots of places I wouldn't like to live and work in at all. But what I'm really asking in saying that it depends on your policy objective is that there are certainly people around, including economists, Dieter Helm, for example, who's recently writing about the Greenbelt, who would think that it shouldn't be a policy objective to meet the whole of demand for housing because of the environmental costs. Now, when I finished my report in 2004, one of the suggestions I made was that government should take a bit of a systematic look at some of the environmental costs of extra house building in the South East, and there was a piece of work done. But I've never subsequently seen any conclusions drawn from it. So I think before you started to say how many houses should you build, the prior question I would raise is, have you thought about whether you want to meet demand, or do you want in some sense to say, no, for environmental reasons, we don't want to meet the whole of demand, and that would inevitably change your answer. However, I haven't got a great answer to the question of whether I would like to meet demand or not, and I suspect, as a matter of fact, I probably would want to meet demand rather than anything else. And I'm afraid, since I see you have Jeff sitting on your right, and since I've always used Jeff's numbers as my guide to what should be done, I would say that if the objective over the next 5 years is to keep the affordability of housing no worse than it is today, or even to reverse it a little bit, we would probably need to be building in around 300,000 houses or in excess of that. And we would also have to be building them in places where there's demand. I don't think if we built 300, if we built them all in around Sheffield, it wouldn't be very useful. But if we spread them around the country, particularly in places of high demand, it would be more useful. But numbers of that order.
300,000. Yeah. Mr. Walker, welcome.
Thank you very much.
We're just starting on the first question. It's Martin Wolfe is going to, which is about the number of houses that we should be targeting over the next 5 years. Mark.
Yeah, I can probably answer this fairly briefly because there are two ways of answering this sort of question, and thank God I've got Kate next to me. One answer is, well, I've got this fully specified model of the British economy, in which I've imposed some sort of welfare function and included the negative externalities associated with environmental costs. And the answer is X. And I don't have such a model. I don't think I'd believe one if I saw one. And so I can't provide, I can't have an answer of that kind. And the other sort of answer, which seems to me the sensible answer from an economist, is I don't know, but clearly rather more than we are building, as we can see from what's happening to prices. If prices are continuing to rise at an extraordinarily rapid rate for a commodity which doesn't seem to me naturally and inevitably scarce on the scale it is. It is clear that we should be building a great many more, and we will find out how many more we need to build in by finding out what happens to prices when we start building seriously, since we're not. I expect them to continue to rise. So I would tend to say the market is showing a profound disequilibrium, and the existence of the disequilibrium indicates that we should be building a great many more. But to be perfectly honest, I don't have the sort of model which would allow me to tell you how many more that would be. I don't know whether anyone does, but I don't know it.
Well, Mr. Walker, have you brought a model with you?
I'm afraid I haven't, but I would broadly concur with Kate Barker that broadly, if we're to keep up with our growing population and the changing population demographics, then we need to be building roughly about 240,000 homes a year in England. And of course, it's important to understand the distinction between England and the UK, and obviously housing is a devolved matter. But if we also want to, it's also estimated that we've got a housing shortage in England in the order of 1 million homes. So in order to address that shortage, as well as cater for the growing population going forward, then again, I would concur with Kate that broadly in England we need to be building about 300,000 homes a year.
Now, do we have the is the industry capable of significantly increasing the number of houses it's built? Because a lot of people left the building trade after the crash, and it's now estimated that there is simply not enough skilled people in the labour force to achieve the sort of 200,000 to 300,000, 250,000 to 300,000 homes. Do you have a view on that?
You didn't at the beginning ask us to introduce ourselves, and had you done so, I would have declared my interest in this matter because I'm on the board of a major house builder. I'm not here representing them, but I can absolutely say that it would be quite difficult to find, it's very difficult in short order to get up to 300 homes. I'm grateful to you saying you reminded me in England, which is a point I usually remember to make, because that would be an increase of perhaps, you know, getting on for 70% more than we are building today. And we know that the increases in house building in the industry over the last year or so have led to increases in cost of materials, increases in cost of some particular trades. And you're completely right. Both some of the manufacturers of material and indeed some of the trades have gone out of business in the last, you know, just they've just gone in the, and they, and many people have gone out of the industry as well. Small companies have gone out of the industry. There is, of course, a question as to whether you could sort of materially affect this situation by using more custom build. There's the various things about custom build. One, of course, is that it's they can be quite inflexible as dwellings when you've got them in, because their properties are such that they're not so easy to change once they're there. And the second thing, of course, is we haven't got any factories producing custom build, so I'm not entirely sure in the short term it would help you. But no, I think the industry would not be capable of going from here to 300,000 in short order. Over time, with clear signals that that's where we were going, I'm sure that could be done. But I would be really startled if we could get there by 2020.
You talked about custom build. It's noticeable that in Scandinavia, the United States, and in Germany, there's far more of an industrial process involved in house building. Why is that landed on these shores?
I think it's a very difficult question to answer. I was interacting with somebody yesterday, and one of the points that's worth making is that in some of these countries where they do have more custom build, they undertake much more demolition. Mm. I made the point that the housing isn't necessarily very flexible, and some of it actually doesn't have such a long lifespan. We have tended, for reasons which perhaps I don't fully understand, to build to last here. So it's worth thinking that if you have custom build, you're going to have to produce more in the long run, because you'll find that they have a slightly shorter lifespan. But I'm slightly puzzled as to why we haven't produced more custom build here. But the truth is, people have not found it very easy to make custom build pay. Indeed, the company that I'm on the board of closed its custom build recently because we weren't finding it profitable.
So we need a modern prefab.
Sorry?
We need a modern prefab.
Yes, but as you know, their lifespan was nothing like as long as it's a traditionally built house.
Paul Teverson.
Yes, thank you, Lord Chairman. I declare my interest as a chairman director of Wessex Investors and also Anchorwood Developments. I only have a slight connection with domestic housing and the social housing area. Generally, in infrastructure, we've become very sceptical about predict and provide, certainly when it comes to transport infrastructure and those sort of things. And I'm just interested to know whether there is any alternative to predict and provide in the housing market. Do we actually have to provide everything for a civilised life for people that want to rent or own a house? Or are there alternative policies that actually mean that we can cope with not providing all the housing that everybody thinks they wants and needs?
Well, perhaps I could pick up on that. I think there's certainly a lot in the argument to be said that meeting the 240,000 or the 300,000 isn't necessarily entirely about supply and building extra homes. There probably is something to be said about changing the way we use our housing stock. So our housing stock isn't used terribly efficiently in this country. We have a lot of under-occupancy, for example, particularly in the owner-occupier sector. And I think there's certainly a problem amongst the older generations, and indeed people of my parents' age who want to downsize and who want to move to a smaller house and not have two or three spare bedrooms, but who don't find who don't have a suitable alternative to downsize to. So I think it's almost like there's a little bit of a gridlock in the housing market, that there isn't the provision of the alternative housing, the smaller housing, the bungalows that older people want to downsize to. And I think also that certainly when it comes to London, where obviously demand is amongst the most prevalent in the country, there's probably a lot more we could do to encourage a more efficient use of the stock, which starts to get us into conversations about tax, for example.
Baroness Bexley.
We need a lot more houses to be built. There's a disequilibrium in the housing market. How far do each of you think that the planning system is part of the problem and that that will be a block to increasing the number of houses that we build in future?
It seems to me pretty clear that it is a major part. Without it, the main driver of, the main symptom of the disequilibrium is ever-rising land prices. And there are some reasons for land prices to rise, even in the absence of restrictions on its availability for house building, particularly because of particularly valuable locations within an urban conurbation, for example. It's pretty obviously building more in the Green Belt, say, will not necessarily do anything very dramatic about the value of housing in Mayfair. But if you take London as a whole, or any conurbation that I know anything about, the difference in the value of the land which is built upon next to the land which cannot be built upon is so vast that it's impossible not to conclude that the land price in the city overall would fall if more land were made available and used for house building. For homes, and therefore it must be the case that restrictions on the use of land is a fundamental factor in determining the price of housing, and above all of the land on which the houses sit, which is the principal component of the cost of houses in places like London.
I'd like to link my answer, if I may, with the answer to the sort of predict and provide question, because you're sort of right about predict and provide in a way, although of course there are examples of houses that are left empty. But if you're thinking about how do we, I'm saying this because houses, planning areas now are supposed to have this concept of objectively assessed need, which is an interesting concept for two reasons. One is I've never quite understood, I suppose objective means you have no bias in either direction, but since any forecast is inevitably inaccurate, the idea of an objective assessment is a bit odd, and need is the wrong word anyway, it ought to be demand, unless you decide you don't want to meet demand for the environmental reasons I set out earlier, in which case I completely agree with Heston on my left, you would use tax. I mean, this is why I think the policy objective you're trying to get to is such a fundamental problem where you strike the trade-off. On planning, one of the things I've tried to learn to do is to avoid talking about planning as though it was some kind of terrible impersonal force, because, of course, the planning system is in a way trying, although it doesn't necessarily do it very well, to be some mediation of what we as a society want. And you see this in planning, you see this conflict, which has gone on for quite a long time, between the national level, where there's some view about building a lot more houses, and the local level, where local authorities struggle with the question of, you know, gosh, we really have to find places for all these homes. Where are we going to put them that we're not all going to be thrown out at the next local election? So I think we have to be sort of careful to say that it's the planning process as such rather than actually what local electorates think they want. So planners, and planners after all are trying to do the job that I sort of described earlier. They're trying to work out the environmental and welfare considerations of building in different places. I'm not sure they always do it terribly well or articulate in that way, but that of course is what they're trying to do. They're trying to make places work and the transport work, and that's all terribly difficult. To come into your question, I think the NPPF was a big step forward because it gave a very strong lead towards growth. And following it, we had some very good planning guidance then produced, which generally means that you're forcing local authorities to produce housing numbers which at least come up towards the household projections. Jeff will at some point tell you that building in line with the household projections isn't enough because housing is an income elastic good, and so people want more as they get richer. But even if building in line with the household projections was enough, there's a number of problems in the way that the local plans work. I had a look, rather slightly wearisome look, a couple of months ago at the status of planning in Hertfordshire, simply because I live relatively near it. And I added up all the local plans as far as I could ascertain them. It's not easy to ascertain where people are with their local plans. And they only added up in total to 75% of the household projections, which, as I've just said, are not really enough. And why were they too low? Some of them are too low because they've been produced ahead of the NPPF, and there's no particular pressure on some of these places to push them up. Some of them are low, I think, because they're still in the process of being made, and the planning inspector hasn't kind of forced them into cooperation with the other authorities. And so you have this inbuilt tendency in the system to be planning for numbers that are below household projections. And if you're planning below them, given that plans are often not fulfilled, you're almost inevitably going to build below household projections, and they're not high enough. So in that sense, I don't think the planning system works. And, you know, Martin remarked earlier that, and this is very simple, and actually the new planning guidance does give a nod towards it. Really, it's all very well producing these plans for the next 15 years, but none of us really have any idea what's going to happen. But looking at prices in your area really does tell you whether you're producing enough new houses or not. And so I think we, as well as planning, I think very important to plan about where you would want to put the next 100 or 1,000 houses when you had them. But being kind of a bit forceful about whether you want 100 or 1,000 seems to me a bit odd, completely isolated from the market. We saw, after all, in the financial crisis that the effective demand for housing fell very quickly because people just couldn't get finance. So, you know, the market does play a big role. Sorry, that was a very long answer.
Well, would it help if there were stronger powers for the compulsory purchase of brownfield sites?
Would it help if there were?
Yes. It's one of the items that the government has talked about, but it hasn't yet come
about. Yes, I'm very sympathetic to the idea that there should be stronger compulsory purchase, not just for brownfield sites, but actually I'm one of the many people who think that purchasing land with compulsory purchase that hasn't previously been zoned for planning and so has no hope value because you want to establish a new settlement and you can get all the land value out to the public realm. Many people think that this would be a very good way forward to develop more housing at scale. I don't think it would solve the whole problem, but yes, I would support it.
Why isn't it happening? Why hasn't it happened already?
You would have to ask government that. Many of people have been talking about it. I talked about new towns in the review I wrote in 2004. Well, I think one thing is courage. I mean, the difficulty with housing is it has to go somewhere. A new town will be in somebody's constituency. So rather like Heathrow, you know. So there is a question about it. The other thing is that even if you are buying land in quite cheaply, you have to have a funding mechanism to put the infrastructure in early. And of course, public expenditure has been short. But actually, although there's been a lot of talk about new towns, I really don't think there was very much energy put into them under the previous government. And it'd be interesting to see if the present government, which is, although it's not quite clear what their target on housing is, I hope this is a question you will tease out of them. They seem to be more energetic, and maybe they will get on with it.
Okay. On planning permissions, if that is the real constraint, you would expect that any site that had an active planning consent would be immediately developed. But that doesn't seem to be the case, is that there are quite a lot of land where builders could build and aren't building. And are they just holding back because if they wait two or three more years, it'll be even more profitable? Are the incentives to force people to use their planning permissions quickly strong enough?
Well, maybe I could pick up on that.
I mean, I think one of the issues is actually the volume developer business model. In essence, volume developers are margin maximizers, not volume maximizers. And just like any other commercial entity, they are about maximizing profits. And that isn't a criticism, by the way. I mean, that is what they are there to do. And you find that what that translates to is slower build out rates than we might otherwise like to see, because of course if you as a developer you suddenly build a vast number of houses and flood the market with those houses, or certainly the local market, then you affect the selling price of those houses and therefore you don't maximise your margins. And where this is a particular problem is actually here in London, because of course most of the building sites in London are large sites. And there was a study by Molior, I think it was, back in 2014. I think they did another one the year before, which basically shows that no large site, a large site being one with more than 500 consented homes, would build out at more than 100 homes a year. So by deduction, that's less than a 20% build-out rate on large sites. And again, that slow build-out is symptomatic of the profit-maximising nature of things.
Well, there's the thing about the Molière study and the Molière figures, if you look at them, and it is that when they talk about unbuilt permissions, if you have a site of, this is just about the data, a comment about build-out rates is correct. You obviously don't build out to take prices down. It would be an irrational thing to do. But local authorities could, of course, deal with this by making sure the sites get split up a bit more. But one of the problems with the Molière data is if you've got a consent for 100 homes and you've only built out 50, my understanding is that the Molière figures count them all as unbuilt. So you shouldn't think that they immediately translate into how many, into all these permissions being unbuilt. What they mean is you haven't got to the end of the site. So you know, so that's in one sense they overstate the issue. The second issue is that, and I'm speaking here really on my book as a developer, the day you get the planning permission, I mean, the truth is, you're absolutely right. When you get the planning permission, particularly for a big site, you've put a hell of a lot of money into it. So you immediately have a carrying cost of all that money you have put in. So your incentive is to get on the site. Why don't you get on the site the day of the planning permission? Well, generally, you're waiting for your planning conditions to be cleared. And at the moment, one of the issues is that local authorities are so strip their staff down such that you can sometimes wait 2 or 3 months to get your planning permission cleared, during which you're not supposed to make a start on the site because it would be a contravention of what you're supposed to do. So the date you get the permission is not necessarily the date that you have the immediate clearance to start on the site. Then, of course, you do start, you know, with groundworks and, you know, these things, even with the best will in the world, they take time. It will be very interesting to see what the project that the government is, I think, going to trial in North Stow, where they try direct commissioning and put some time limits on people for the build-up rate, how far that succeeds and what that does to sort of pricing. Of course, North Stow is a very, north of Cambridge, as you probably know, it's a very buoyant area, so they should be able to get the housing away. But if you had a big permission in a relatively small town, you really wouldn't want to build it out quickly because the stuff might just stand empty, which wouldn't be helpful to anyone.
Just for some elaboration on this, because the figures that you've given us on build-out rate, I find very hard to equate with the blocks of flats that are coming on stream all over London. So does this mean that actually you have a different way of counting apartments, as they're all known in London now? Because I'm pretty certain that at Battersea, for instance, it's coming along at a rate faster than that you've been talking about.
Well, yes, flats do come along much faster. But you know, you may get permission for two or three blocks, and you obviously build them a block at a. You don't generally build all three; you build them a block at a time. And with flats, particularly, you obviously like to have pre-sale because you want to know before you start on building 100 flats you've sold a few.
Maybe we need to be clear about terminology, because for the purposes of this inquiry, I tend to think of an apartment as being a home. Just as much as a house. Yeah. But the tendency is always to talk about houses. And I just wonder whether that skews the thinking generally.
If you were given a clean sheet of paper, you're asked to advise the government and say, how could you speed up the planning process? What would it be? And in particular, one house builder argued to me recently that a major constraint was the number of planning staff local authorities have. If that is as serious a problem as they claim it is, isn't there a case for saying that there should be a special increase in public expenditure to the local authorities in order to make sure that planning staff are not being let go?
If I may, I think that's absolutely right, and I agree with the diagnosis, certainly from the developers that I speak to, that there is an issue of a lack of planners in planning departments and capacity to deliver, and that there are bottlenecks in the system as a result of that. But what I think is quite surprising, and actually perhaps we shouldn't be so surprised about this, is that actually many developers would be prepared to pay higher fees and more fees themselves to have more planners in departments if only they could. So it doesn't even necessarily have to be about public money necessarily.
No, that's absolutely true. Because the cost of sitting waiting before you can start is quite great. And if the price of it was to pay somebody's wages for a week to get them to sign off your conditions, you'd be very happy to do it.
Lord Monks.
But the other thing is it would help you to plan, because the issue when you're, obviously a big developer, you have a number of sites and you have a number of staff, and you want to be able to know when you'll be able to move people from A to B.
Do you want to follow on?
I just want to say I forgot to declare my interest, which I should have done. I'm the chairman of a housing association, which is also a house builder, Orbit.
Lord Monks.
Yeah, can I just throw in another hot potato into our discussion, and it's the land value tax, and whether this is a way of shaking out some land for development. We're aware Martin Wolf has written about this over a good few years now and advocated it. Interested in the views of all of you on the subject, and do you think that this is a way that would put pressure on developers to get on with those many areas they've got where they've got planning permission but sit on the land in the hope of some property inflation? And if that's not going to work, what will work to against this background of rising land prices, which make it economic in many cases to hang on to the land until you can get more for it?
Well, let me comment on this. There are a number of different reasons why we might want to change our taxation of land and property, not least that it's a fearful mess. It's difficult to just change one bit without thinking about some of the others. I see you're just here have a question about council tax, which is obviously a quite extraordinary thing. But on the specific issue of land tax, it seems to me that there are three reasons why one might be interested in pursuing this direction. First, that it's a way simply of appropriating a substantial part of the value of land, and there are good fiscal reasons why you would want to tax land rather than other things. for efficiency reasons. And the more we can tax land rents, the lower we can push other taxes, some of which are highly distorting. So there's this general Henry George type argument. That's a fundamental change in the basis of our tax system, but it seems to me personally attractive. The second reason is actually linked with what Kate talked about. It's just another way of doing this thing, which is something I've been thinking about a lot, which seems to me central in this discussion, which is how do you change the incentives for local authorities? I mean, it seems to me under our current fiscal arrangements that they do seem to be changing rather rapidly in ways whose implications I don't fully understand. From a point of almost any local authority, the net benefit, both political and economic, the two are very closely related, of development of housing is negative. So why would they do it? I mean, they're not going to get any significant revenue gain from it. They are going to get an awful lot of grief from their existing residents, and they're going to incur a very large number of costs associated with infrastructure of all sorts. So why should a local authority want to promote development? It's in its rational interest not to do so. So one wants to think about taxes which will accrue to local authorities, which will adequately compensate them for their costs. Now, one very simple one, which Kate suggested, and it is essentially a tax arrangement, is you buy the property at current value and sell it at the future value. But land value taxes are just a way of annuitizing, if you like, that sort of process. So you could clearly associate those with local taxes. That's rather different from the Henry George type thing, which is national. But this is one way, and it seems to me an incredibly important basic aim of our policy change, is to motivate local authorities to actually get a return. And actually, by the way, I think the residents themselves, one reason why residents might be happier to accept incomers is if their own taxes were to fall, because of very large taxes were to be imposed on the development itself. And the final one is indeed what Lord Marks just mentioned, which is it would be a way of stimulating use of land which is idle. It would increase the carrying cost of land. At the moment, interest costs are extremely low, obviously, if you are a large developer in current circumstances. There are obviously some costs associated with holding land, but if the appreciation of the land value is significant, it seems to me perfectly rational to wait for the development. It's not in the least surprising why people... I'm not suggesting that's the only reason. Other good reasons have been given here. And a land tax, site value tax, is related to the value in its current planned use, assuming the planning has occurred, would, I think, be a very useful stimulus for development. And I've been arguing this for about 15 years, completely unsuccessfully. So that's how I see some of the core tax issues in this.
I don't agree with Martin on this. So it's a stimulating area of debate, I hope. I do agree with him on the first thing he said, however, which is that we ought probably to tax land more than we do, and we also ought to see housing and property tax the system and make a number of reforms. And I think there, on council tax and other things, there's much more agreement between us. And I think it's partly for equality reasons, given that and the standard sort of Henry George type reasons. Where I think it becomes more difficult is taxing land in the right way to produce incentives for development. And there are two proposals here, which you mentioned one and Martin mentioned the other. One is that when you give a permission that you sort of start a tax running. I hope you would only start it running when you'd got the local authority to sign off. And maybe this would be a good incentive for them to sign off if they were to get the tax thing. So that would work well. And I don't disagree either with the idea that more of the revenue that implicitly comes in, if you're able to use more of development for the public purse, should be used locally. It's a sort of extension in a way of the 106 idea. But I think one thing you sort of need to think about is what, if you tax permissioned land, what does it do to your incentives? I mean, it's a criticism about getting a sort of permission for a large area of land and building it out slowly, and that may be true, but actually in that, if you had this change that you tax permissioned land, you wouldn't ever want permission for 1,000 houses. You apply for your permission in little slugs, which would be relatively inefficient and cost everybody a lot of money, but would save you some money. So that's the first thing. The second thing is it would, of course, raise the risk to developers if you're having to pay tax, and there's a risk that the market will turn. You don't want to build out so quickly. So which would, of course, just get eaten into the land price. So it would mean less money went to landowners, however, which we might regard as a good thing, because it's landowners really who get the money generally in the end rather than developers. They get landowners clearly get the residual developers, as it were, after the margin. But I can see why people think it would be a sort of little bit of kind of grit that would encourage people to build out a bit faster. So although I don't agree with that, I can see the attraction of it. Land in a plan, however, I find really difficult. And I tell you why this is, and it's a sort of obvious reason. So I'm Tame District Council in Oxfordshire, and I want to build X houses, and I allocate the land for it over a 10-year period. You couldn't possibly want to tax it all, because you wouldn't want them all built in the same year. So you might then create a bit of an incentive for people to get in early, but actually the person who doesn't get their permission till the 10th year, because that's when the planner wants them built, would then have had to pay tax on this high land value for what would strike me as a disproportionate length of time. And during that time, the planning system might change and it might go out of the plan. And then what do you do? So that's why I find it difficult to tax in its planned value. Sorry, Martin wants to argue with me, so...
Well, I think there are solutions to all these problems. I believe that one could create a regime in which, which is certainly one I would want, a presumptive permission. But it could be one in which one has... it would be perfectly possible, it seems, for the council to have the following policy. This is following area has presumptive permission at a certain point, relating to the speed with which it wishes to see the development. It says this is now designated for development and the tax date starts then. So it doesn't seem to me particularly problematic if the tax begins at the point at which the decision has been made that we now want to see the development. So I'm not particularly troubled by this. I think it could be perfectly well handled.
I have to say, as a developer, if I owned a bit of land and I'd got it in a plan and the market had shifted and the town council suddenly wrote and said, actually, we'd like you to build that now, I'd be a bit peeved.
If this is, seems to be
self-evident. Making developers happy is not my main objective in this. Let me make it very clear. I actually do believe that it's pretty clear that almost anything we're going to do is likely, well, we know this is the case, almost anything we're going to do to improve these things is likely to make some developers very unhappy.
And I think that's true. And indeed, the proposition about taking the new land, which I do agree with, and using it for the public purse, would neither suit developers nor landowners.
Correct.
As a matter of fact, that doesn't mean I'm opposed to it. I think it's in the more normal planning system that I just think the land value tax is overplayed as a solution.
So this seems to be an eminently sensible idea. Why hasn't it been taken up?
Well, there are one or two countries that have tried it. I think this gets... Well, there are so many reasons. There are very powerful interests against it. I think that's pretty obvious. In most societies, and certainly ours, landowners are extremely powerful people. That's important. I think there's the other aspect of it, which I think is very interesting, and it gets in the way of almost all sensible... property-related taxes. So, just again, because I think it was Christopher who mentioned the point about people living in large houses with four empty or three empty bedrooms. Why is that easy? Well, because, of course, one of the reasons is you don't get taxed very much on owning this. But if we raise taxes, just to give an example, to a level at which would encourage people to move down and liberate housing for families, young families, we would then be said we're penalising Granny who wants to stay in her house. Because the point being that people feel very strongly, it seems to me, that taxes that are not attached to income, that are not a burden on, that are not easily payable against income, are somehow wrong and immoral. And I think that's a very powerful feeling, and it gets in the way of what I see as rational taxation policy. And I have to recognise that's a reality, though I think it's unfortunate.
Thank you. Lord Turnbull.
I declare an interest also as a director of British Land, which has a small residential business, most not particularly at the affordable level, mostly at the unaffordable level.
presumably not completely unaffordable.
Somebody must have been, yes.
By British
business.
People. Can I? This is really the first question, really, for Christopher Walker. You talked about the business model of volume builders. Is one of the things we might do is try to bring into play people who have a different business model, i.e. housing associations, who might be margin satisfiers. They've got to earn a certain margin, but have a mandate to maximise volume subject to that constraint. And a lot of the things we seem to be doing at the moment, like the constraint on rents and the right to buy, which is reduces their ability to pledge collateral, interest uncertainty, is mostly going against that.
I absolutely agree with the sentiment. I mean, if for example, let's just take some very sort of high level numbers. If we need to build 240,000 homes a year to meet our growing demand, many of the developers I speak to and developer organisations believe that under the current planning system and under the current arrangements, they will never build more than 150,000-160,000 a year. So, of course, that automatically begs the question, where are the rest going to come from? And I think in that housing associations have an absolutely pivotal role to play in that, because, of course, housing associations aren't, they can't really be described as margin maximisers. In a sense, they are more volume maximisers in that, you know, part of their charitable purpose is about, you know, having maximum delivery of affordable housing. And as I wrote in my report last year on housing associations, I think the sector is capable of building 100,000 homes a year. That would plug the gap. But I think the magnitude of the problem is so great, that the challenge and the scale is so great, that we need all the players to come back in. We need smaller and medium-sized builders encouraged back in. We've had over the last two or three decades the decimation of the number of house builders in the sector. The numbers, I mean, it's quite staggering, the decline in the number of builders that we now have. And, of course, every time we go through a recession, you have this huge ratcheting down effect in capacity and the number of builders. And I think one of the things I would like to say about government policy, and obviously we've got the Housing and Planning Bill, is that perhaps self-build and custom build will be one way of trying to encourage the smaller player and the medium players back in, because I think we really do need them.
Can I turn to a point that Martin Morse made about local government? I haven't fully digested what the Chancellor said last week.
Neither have I.
Turning local authorities into bodies which have two streams of revenue, the business rate returned to them after 30 years, and the council tax, which is their money, and that they largely, by the end of the parliament, are supposed to be more or less grant-free. Sounds as though that's a very major change in the incentive structure of local authorities. I think it may create a pendulum, may swing so violently the other way, that we'll find that the real problem is the lack of equalisation. At the moment, we have too much equalisation in the system, because if you're successful, that money is just fed back into the pool and goes to Hartlepool or somewhere. Now, in 5 years' time, we'll be worrying that those less prosperous areas find it difficult to survive under this regime. But if it's, as he presented it very briefly last week, it could be a very major change.
Yes, I think this is, I have thought about it and I just commented on it briefly. So there are aspects of this I certainly don't understand. This is what I understood from what I read, and Treasury documents are not always pellucid. But there will be controls on, quite complicated regime of controls on the rates councils may charge. So they can't change the business rate easily. But there are, as I understand it, mechanisms that will permit it to. There does seem to be implicit in it, that wasn't completely explicit, that if they developed the business life of their area in such a way as to increase the rent, increase the rate, the rates that would accrue in the first place to the local authority. So that seemed to provide an encouragement for development, at least for commercial development. The same would seem to be true even now under the council tax. It's just such an inadequate tax. However, it is clear that, but not clear how, that redistribution among local authorities would continue. That is stated in the documents. Because, I mean, pretty obviously, if the entire business rates of Westminster went to Westminster, we would have a pretty big problem. It would be absurd. So there are, it does seem to me at first reading, and you obviously have to talk to Treasury ministers, that there will now be a greater link between the development of the local area's business life and the revenue accruing to the local authority, which seems to me very desirable. But there are consequences of this and feature of this, in particular the way the revenue will be reallocated among authorities, which are, to me at least at the moment, still very, very unclear. And of course, under sufficiently aggressive reallocation, the incentive would be very, very considerably attenuated. And finally, the council tax doesn't fit in with the business rate regime. So you've got a housing tax, which once upon it did, obviously. So we've got a housing tax, a property tax structure for personal housing and a property tax structure for business, which is going to be clearly going to create all sorts of strange anomalies, which I couldn't work through at this stage.
Can I get a final question for me? The reference to the Dieter Helm view that you've got kind of economy A, where you try to meet demand, and economy B, where you recognise you're not going to try and meet demand. That means between the two, there are some people who would otherwise get a house to rent or buy who will not. Mm. And we must have a view about what is the kind of tolerable minimum standards that we are prepared to allow people to live in.
That is correct.
Yes, I mean, I wouldn't really attribute that to Dieter Helm, although I would attribute some environmental views. I mean, in some sense, the view about the fact that we could share the houses more fairly is more a Danny Dawling view, that we don't need to build anymore, we just need to share them around. I think my problem is that you're absolutely right if we don't, you know, but I mean, a good question is, so we've built over the last X years about 90,000 homes a year fewer than we sort of feel was demand, and you sort of say, well, you know, goodness me, we don't see a million people hanging about the streets, where are they all? And the answer is, of course, that the young people are all living at home with their parents as opposed to moving out into flats. Is this a tremendous social ill? I don't know. People in social housing probably have a little, still, although there are many people who are only occupied, 8.1 in England and Wales, are two or more spare rooms. There are at one point about a million people in social housing who are overcrowded, and they're probably a little bit more overcrowded than they were. And we've been quite good at using up the empty stock. I mean, the empty stock has come back into play at a tune of about 20,000 a year. So we've accommodated it. The question is, how much longer can we accommodate it? And do we really want to do it this way? Because if you decide you're not going to build to demand, but you're not going to tax for the reasons that Martin gave, we really hate taxing property. What you end up with is a huge incentive for people who can afford it to buy space they don't need, and you force the poor to huddle up. Now, that's fine. That's a result. The question is, do you like it? Yes, I don't like it.
It's not fine, no.
So I would either build more or tax or do a bit of both. If you carry on doing nothing, you will have the poor very huddled up.
Owning a house bigger than you need is surely the most rational investment strategy for anybody in Britain who has the money.
Yeah.
And that is exactly what we're seeing. And Mr. Dawling then said,
"Is it Dawling?
That we don't use property well," which is completely correct, but it's baked into the cake.
Yeah.
Baroness Whitcroft.
With only two houses that you don't really need, it's even better.
Well, the Chancellor seems to have a view on that, though only if you buy them, when you buy them. But then nobody will. Well, that gets related to what taxes we can impose. It is fascinating to me, truly fascinating, that the one tax we can impose without any real worry is stamp duty, because there's money at the time, but of course from the point of view of any economist, it's the least efficient tax, apart from the fact that you can raise the revenue, which is, of course, from the Treasury's point of view, I do understand, is a pretty important feature of a tax.
And it's quite flexible. I think it's quite a useful tax to have in your armoury.
Yes.
But it's now become the principal.
But I agree with you, it shouldn't be the first one you reach for.
Could I ask you, though, about the existing government interventions, particularly Help to Buy? Martin Wolf has been vigorous in his attacks on the results of Help to Buy, and yet the government remains committed to it, and it continues to do it. Would there be a more efficient use of government help in the housing market? For instance, listening to what you were saying earlier, would it make far more sense for government to invest in providing the infrastructure in certain areas, freeing up the land, much more land, and potentially creating a supply that would at least not push prices further and further up?
I suppose there are two profound questions, and some of the profound questions were already raised. And we get one of the most profound questions is whether the government should have a strong view about the way in which the right to occupy a house is realised. That is to say, should it have a preference for home ownership, the individual, the owner-occupier vis-a-vis the rent, the rental sector? This government seems to, as I understand see it, increasingly to have decided that it ought to favour owner occupation. There are already very large incentives for owner occupation inherent in our tax system, because the imputed rent isn't taxed, which is a point I made in my thesis approximately 40 years ago, so it hasn't changed. So there's a very large built-in incentive, and we've added further incentives over time through the treatment of capital gains tax for owner occupation. The government is now increasing incentives further. I cannot see any good reason for this, but that's a fundamental question. So one of my objections to Help to Buy is that it's oriented to helping that part of the income distribution which would like to buy. And that here we're not talking about people who want to be housed. And most of those people are, I think, young people in the middle to upper parts of the income distribution. And I cannot see for the life of me why they should be a high priority in the current, my children, as it were. I don't see the sense of that. But there's a fundamental set of issues there. Then the second question is, would this sort of scheme help to deal with what we all agree, I think, in different ways, is the fundamental problem, which is supply? And without changes elsewhere, I mean, it doesn't seem to me that insufficiently high prices, i.e. insufficient reward for building, can be the main reason why people aren't building, given what's happened to house prices. So further pushing up house prices by subsidising the purchase doesn't seem to me a very well-targeted incentive in the housing system. For these two reasons, I have indeed been very critical of this policy, and that doesn't mean I don't fully understand the political rationale, because it's obvious.
And we haven't talked about being able to pass on the family home.
Well, that's another inheritance tax thing. On that subject, I'm afraid words fail me.
But would anybody differ on
Help to Buy? I think I partly differ. I mean, obviously, home ownership is clearly at the centre of government's housing policy at the moment, and indeed it's been at the centre of Conservative Party thinking for a long time. And the fact of the matter is that most surveys and most polling does show that most people want to or aspire to own. So, for example, the British Social Attitudes Survey, I think, shows considerably more than 80% of people wanting to own. And of course it is a big problem for the government, because we've seen home ownership rates decline in this country in recent years. They've declined from about 70% in 2002 to just over 63% today. And much of that decline has been amongst young people. So if you take the subset of under 35-year-olds, households within that. I think the home ownership rate decline is something from like 2/3 to just over 40%. So what you're seeing is basically a squeezing out of young people from home ownership. So it's become a sort of a generational equity issue point as well, I think. So I think at one level, the government is absolutely right to try and intervene on that. And of course, starter homes and shared ownership is certainly starter homes are obviously targeted at younger people being for under 40-year-olds, but shared ownership as well. But of course, you know, more generally, the fall in home ownership levels is more broadly symptomatic of a deterioration in affordability in the wider market more broadly. So yes, it's right at one level for the government to intervene in tenure space, if I can describe it that way, but ultimately, I don't think the government can reverse that decline in home ownership until it starts building many, many more homes and improves affordability in the general market.
That's a bit differently, if I may, which is that one of the things that I know some economists criticise is the taxing on buy-to-let, because people say, well, why are we doing this? Shouldn't we have a level playing field? I think the problem here is that I generally agree with things people have said, but on the whole, I think, you know, that it comes back to a sort of equality question. If, as I think we've argued very clearly, we aren't building enough houses to meet demand, so the pressure on prices is ever upwards. There is an incentive, obviously, for anybody who has money to buy the damn things, and people with money in the buy-to-let market have been advantaged over people trying to get mortgages because of the very otherwise sensible change in the mortgage regime. And so what I would say government is doing, when other people say, well, it's creating an unlevel playing field, I would say it is kind of trying to level it up a bit from an equality point of view. And I think it's better. I would prefer them to do that, to raise a bit of money by taxing buy-to-let people, than by subsidising home ownership, Well, I generally agree with Martin. I think the new build scheme was helpful when it was introduced, by the way, because supply was still in a difficult state and the mortgage market was then very tight. So I think when it started off, it did also have beneficial effects on supply. I'm less positive about it as a continuing policy.
And how would you feel if government were to use its resources instead to prime the infrastructure for potential housing developments, or indeed to give grants to people living in large houses so that they could divide them in two?
Well, I would prefer it if government sold its own land a bit more cheaply, mm-hmm. and, you know, didn't always sell it at the top price and was then able to use some of the infrastructure to build places. I have no problem with people dividing their homes into two, although, you know, as we said earlier, in some sense this is a question of housing space. People do want more.
Yeah.
People do want more space. I thought you were going to say grants to help the older people move, which I would also favour, although yeah. often, of course, you don't want to move because there isn't a suitable house that state keeps you in your community. This is, you know, the problem is we are very home isn't just a physical thing, it is when you've been there a long time, more than that. But I think there are many better ways to use the money than on help to buy. I don't think there's a shortage of them.
Thank you.
Griffiths.
I have two questions. The first is to Martin Wolf, which is from society's point of view, not the individual's point of view, are you totally indifferent between renting and owning? I tell you why.
Okay, let me put it this way. I think at the margin, this is perhaps a bit of a cop, but my answer is yes. If I were told that the consequence of this would be that we might end up as I understand it, in the Victorian era, and I'm not an expert on this, but it's my understanding, approximately 90% of people rented and 10%, and therefore by definition, the land was owned, the properties were owned by people who lived off the rent. Would it be undesirable to go back to that sort of world from a social point of view, because it would profoundly affect people's sense, which I think is the underlying thinking here, of whether they have a stake in society, of their owning something that is real to them? even if that was the result of largely of clearly expressed preferences. They individually, they couldn't see, because it's a long-term contract, it's secure, the rental doesn't change as it didn't in the Victorian era. I probably would be prepared to say, well, if that were the consequence, I will begin to get worried. But within the margins that we are now seeing, I'm less worried about the fact that people can't buy their houses. The reason that I'm worried that people can't buy their houses, and this is a real issue, is there are such enormous privileges, benefits in owning houses. So because the tax regime implicitly and explicitly is so favourable to owning houses, if a very large proportion of the population are unable to buy houses, then we have a problem because it is a profound inequity. That does seem to me a problem. The first best solution, of course, is to get rid of these tax anomalies, since we are most unlikely to reintroduce Schedule A at a sensible level. That does provide me with... I mean, I'm not terribly unhappy, therefore, with the taxation of right to buy landlords. It doesn't seem to me a very big problem, though I wouldn't have done it in the way that the Chancellor has proposed. I do accept there are some big issues. First, this stake in the country thing, but second, and more important to me, is there just such large benefits in being an owner-occupier that if a very small proportion of the population, a relatively small proportion of the population receives those gains, it will be perceived, and rightly, as entrenching quite an important unfairness.
Can I thank you very much for that? Can I now ask my second question, which is that in the summer budget and the autumn statement, there have been a number of changes in relation to social rents, or rents for social housing. Firstly, in the summer budget, they were coming down 1% a year for 3 or 4 years. Then, if you had an income over 30,000, you're going to have to pay much nearer a market rent for social housing. And in the autumn statement, it was said that housing benefit would only cover a certain, it'd be capped in relation to the amount you paid for rent. The question is, in relation to these changes which have been made to rents, what effect do you think it's going to have on the supply of social housing?
I'm actually, I think, pretty clearly the wrong person to ask this. So I'm going to ask Kate whether she would like to deal with that. I mean, I have not worked through... There are two issues here. Yeah. I haven't worked through the net effect of all this on the returns to social housing. It's obviously very complicated and probably depend very much on the particular social housing provider and the particular mix of tenants they have, the incomes and so forth. That's the first point, so it's really quite detailed. The second point is more about which does worry me very much with the recent developments in housing policy, by the way, no way unique to this government, which is the constant changes in policy and unpredictability of policy must make the lives of everybody trying to make decisions in this sector more difficult, and I would imagine that must apply to social housing providers as well. Okay.
I haven't done any of my own work on this either. I would use the OBR's estimates on the grounds that they have done the work, which were that the cut, I think, would cost 14,000 over the next 5 to 6 years. I have no better estimate than that. And I have to say, truthfully, I don't work very closely on the whole issues around the rented sector either. But I mean, I think a sort of follow-up to the comments Martin was making about the advantages of people having home ownership. The truth is that if you think about the people in this country who are really struggling with housing costs at the moment, they're people mostly in the rented sector, not people in the household sector. And that, of course, is an effect of all the things we've been talking about. And I do feel uncomfortable with a set of policies which seem designed, as I think we're all saying, to be supportive of reasonably well-off people who are just on the cusp of buying and just need that little nudge to get them over the edge, at the expense of people who really aren't in the buying area but are sort of stuck in a rental sector which is becoming more and more difficult. The only positive thing I can say is that the move to tax buy-to-let but not so much corporates might improve the standards of the renting sector, because you might get a more professional renting sector
against that, I was sort of unhappy when landlords lost their allowance for repair and maintenance. I would have preferred them to be inspected to make sure they'd done the repair and maintenance, which would have seemed to me more helpful to raise standards in that sector, which are often too low.
I don't think I would concur with all of that sentiment. I think the government is in essence it's changing its direction on affordable housing and changing it quite fundamentally, and it's going much more in the direction, again, as part of its home ownership push, to extend that home ownership envelope and the home owning democracy to households on their incomes, including those who would have traditionally been thought of as social renters. So you have the right to buy extension policy, you have shared home ownership, and you had the announcement, obviously, at spending review for 400,000 homes, most of which will be for some form of home ownership or another. So it's this move away from affordable housing as subsidised rentals towards affordable housing, which is subsidised home ownership. And I think it was significant at spending review because for the first time, more grant money will be spent on affordable home ownership products than will be spent on affordable rented or social rented products, which were obviously social rents were phased out for grant in 2010, obviously. But that is, for me, a watershed. It's the government saying that we will no longer mass support submarket rental products through new grant money. We will only support home ownership. And that is a change of direction. But it is about, again, boosting home ownership. And the government saying, we believe that home ownership should be available to a much wider pool of people than has traditionally thought to be the case.
Lord Tiverson.
Just say gently that in the United States, when they did that, it didn't necessarily end well, and that alongside these policies, slightly cheap point, but alongside these policies, we have, of course, made the support for people who fall into difficulties with their mortgages less good, which seems to me somewhat illogical.
It's just so important. I am very worried about the social consequences of this. It seems to me that there are a large number of families sort of on... with children, it's particularly important, on the edge, who don't have whose incomes are not necessarily very regular. Owning a house has large burdens associated with it. Large costs might arise, which you, with repairs you have to make, which you might not be able to meet. Shifting support away from rent at this part of a society, in my view, is likely to prove in the long run an unworkable policy. But the proof will be in the pudding.
Lord Tiverson.
Yes, I just wanted to follow up on a question of this. We had an evidence session with the Chancellor of the Exchequer a couple of months ago, and this was one of the areas, social housing, that we dealt with, and it was one of the more contentious areas, I think, that we had, and Baroness Blackstone asked a number of questions in particular. But I got the impression from the Chancellor of the Exchequer, although it wasn't official policy, he sort of gave the impression that one of the reasons that this was quite a good policy, reducing rents, was because social housing associations really had quite an easy life. They weren't performing as well as they should do, and they ought to have a bit of a kick to get on and fulfil what he wanted to fulfil. I paraphrase completely, but I would be interested in your views on whether social housing associations actually have delivered what we should expect of them.
I think there has been a concern that, particularly around housing associations, perhaps not being the best delivery vehicle for new affordable housing supply in this country, and there are all sorts of things within that. So, obviously, one of the biggest issues that the government is I think grappling with is how it can drive more efficiencies in the sector. So you have a sector which is made up of over 1,500 organisations, including a very long tail of very small organisations. You know, is there something within that which basically suggests that we don't have the most efficient structure within the sector? I think that's one thing, and one reason why consolidation could be a good idea in the sector. But I think the other another issue is that, of course, housing associations have been making very, very big surpluses in recent years. So last year, the housing association sector made a surplus of £2.4 billion. No, 2.5, I think it was. So these are very large sums of money, two-thirds of which is paid for by housing benefits. So at one level, one might say the government is right to be asking those sorts of questions of housing associations about how can you do more.
Are these held as cash mountains, or are they... How would they help?
Some of the money is held in reserve. But again, this is in defence of housing associations. It's partly because there are so many uncertainties ahead. So you've got all the welfare reforms going on. So housing associations feel that they have to keep more of a buffer to protect themselves against those uncertainties. So there are two sides to this.
I don't have terribly strong views. In the days when I was at the House, when I was on the board as the Homes and Communities Agency, and before that, the Housing Corporation, it seemed to me, when we were trying then to persuade people to invest more and make sure they use their money efficiently, it seemed to me that actually operationally some of the associations are much more efficient than each other, and there wasn't much of a you know, but it's quite difficult to sort that out because in some sense they're not running businesses. On the other hand, many of them do very good work. They have to deal often with very difficult tenants. Private landlords don't have to deal with difficult tenants. Housing associations do. It's quite right that they have to think about risk. A number of associations ran into financial difficulties which had to be kind of managed away during the crisis. The whole sector got into difficulties. It wouldn't be very clever. And finally, on mergers, my recollection is that the evidence was generally when we merged them, it didn't make much difference. But you're right. There are a lot of very small ones. But in some sense, I don't think it's the small ones you're worried about. You should ask the G10, the G15, or whatever they're called about their policies.
I just want to make one terribly simple point. I don't have any particular views about housing associations. I don't know enough about them. It would be ridiculous to claim I do. But I even did my thesis on British housing policy. It seems to me the evidence we have is now absolutely unambiguous. We will need a sector that provides affordable rental housing. There's no doubt about it. Absolutely none. And this can be done through local authorities. We've decided that wasn't a terribly good idea. It can be done through housing associations, or it can be done through private landlords with housing benefit. We're not very happy with the latter. It creates all sorts of problems, including problems for the Treasury. We don't want the local authorities, so housing associations is what we have. I fully concur, of course, with the Chancellor's objective to make them as efficient as possible, but they are going to survive, and I would guess over a lengthy period, and they're likely actually to become more important rather than less for the structural reasons we've already discussed. And building, sort of imagining that in some way that this sector and therefore their clients will disappear seems to me pretty fanciful.
Okay. Perhaps I could lead on then to ask about the right to buy, which was a commitment made during the election and one that's being fulfilled at the moment, if through the strange voluntary mechanism rather than through legislation in the housing bill that's going through Parliament at the moment. Do you feel this is reasonable and equitable? Certainly the Chancellor of the Exchequer, when he was here, said it puts such tenants on an equal par with council tenants of old, so it was non-discriminatory. Having said that, clearly it can be seen as a windfall gain to a very small number of people. And I would be interested also in your comments as to whether you feel this affects different parts of the country or others. I get involved in a number of rural issues, and it's felt particularly this could be a threat more to rural areas than maybe urban. I'd be interested in your comments on that side as well, of this particular proposal.
Sorry, just the two points. I don't know about the rural versus urban. I'd be interested in Chris's view. I've written a column on this. I'm on the record. So I think it's an outrageous policy. That was pretty obvious that I do. I think it's expropriation, quite shocking. But I have to stress that, though this is not for that reason, that I'm probably the only person left in Britain who thought the original right to buy was absolutely objectionable. So I don't think public property should be given away to the fortunate few at sub-market prices. That was the way Queen Elizabeth ran her public finances, and I don't think it's improved since then. I'm probably not the right person to ask. But on this particular case, the purpose of housing associations is to provide affordable rental housing. That's why they were created. That is why they've been supported. And it seems to me they should be left alone to do that, rather than be encouraged to provide a windfall to a limited number of successful and happy incumbents. So that's my view.
Can you be clearer?
Probably, but it wouldn't improve my reputation.
I always think the great thing about getting evidence as Martin is you can sound enormously moderate while being. I completely agree. I have to say I'm really glad you said that. I agree with it completely.
Well, I completely disagree with that. fundamentally. If you're talking about roughly the same subset of society, for me there is no difference between subsidising home ownership and subsidising rent. What is fundamentally the difference? For example, subsidising someone through rent with social rent at 60% of market rates, which is roughly what it is at the national average, or giving somebody a 40% discount on buying their home. They're at the sort of very high level, there's no difference. They're both subsidies and they're both given ultimately for equitable reasons. But I also think on the right to buy policy specifically, I think we should welcome it. I think we should welcome right to buy extension as a new funding stream for new build affordable housing through the one-for-one replacement mechanism. And I do caveat it with that, because I do think I am in agreement with Kate and Martin that actually the original policy, which didn't have one-for-one replacement, was problematic, and it did see the decimation of, not the decimation, but certainly a significant reduction in the social housing stock. So I think so long as we can do the one-for-one replacement and that can be met, then it is, it's a new source of funding. It's a new source of money to build new replacement affordable housing with. It's a contribution to our overall housing supply, and for that reason, I think we should be a bit more positive about it. It's innovative.
Can I just, sorry, Chairman, just one last little bit on this, and that is, you mentioned one-to-one replacement, but I think the most recent parts of right to buy of the previous one have never managed to get anywhere near that.
Well, let's
sorry.
I agree with the theory.
We're rapidly coming up to 5 o'clock.
I apologise, Lord Chairman.
I don't want to keep you here past supper, so perhaps we could move on.
Yes,
and I think if you agree with what the other speaker says, and on that particular question, if you clearly didn't, then perhaps we can move on even more swiftly. Lord Sharkey.
Yes, I apologise. I'm going to have to leave in a moment, so I'm not going to ask the question that I was going to ask, Lord Forsyth. Take over, I hope.
Which question were you going to ask?
I was going to ask this question here. Instead, I'm going to ask a question that probably has a very short answer. I just wondered, listening to all this, whether there is any experience elsewhere, any examples of successful approaches to speedily increasing housing supply that might help guide us. Is this a problem that's absolutely unique to this country? Has it never been encountered before? Has anybody dealt with it in a way that is contains some lessons for the future?
Well, I'm not sure I can think of anywhere that has very successfully increased their supply of housing more quickly. I'm much more struck by the fact that these problems are becoming more widespread, partly because, of course, population growth is very great. So the only country I've done any significant amount of work in is Australia. There is some literature on comparative housing markets. They all come from very different backgrounds. Martin's talked about our kind of predisposition not to like taxes on housing, and that isn't quite the same. That isn't quite the same elsewhere. In other places, they're more willing. I mean, people see council tax, for example, as a tax as payment for services. I think of it as a tax for occupying that bit of land. That's a huge difference. But the truth is, there isn't huge evidence that people do this very much better, although there is a great tendency to think, and I agree with this partly because, as Chris has already said, it might help stimulate some of the small builders. There is some merit, I think, in local authorities being more active in the land market and preparing what people call serviced plots, which they then sell off to small builders, because that would help to get the thing going. And that is done successfully in Germany and the Netherlands, and I think is an example worth copying. But there's a lot to, goodness me, there's a lot to say if you start on international comparisons.
I'd only make 2 points. My impression from them looking at the comparative literature on price movements is that we do seem to be doing exceptionally badly compared to other European countries, countries with comparable density problems, in terms of the movement of affordability. Now, that may be partly due to the exceptional role of London in our economy, and that must be part of it. But I do think we have to start from the assumption that we are an outlier. We are an outlier. The second is, there's quite interesting evidence. I just underline what Kate said. The first time I came to learn of it actually was Policy Exchange pamphlets, build, written in the early 2000s by Oliver Ledwich. I don't know whether you remember him. Which did indicate that this set of incentives working particularly in Germany, but to a lesser degree the Netherlands, were more effective, and that we could learn something from them. And certainly the Germans have succeeded in avoiding the extreme bubbles and collapses that other European countries have had. If we want to learn, however, about how not to increase supply, we could take a very close look at Spain. Or, if we want to get closer to home, Ireland.
Yeah. Although now they have undersupply in some places. It's amazing how quickly you can go from one to the other with a flexible population.
Lord Forsyth.
Could I apologise for being late? I was involved with the European referendum bill on the floor of the House. I should also declare an interest as a director of a bank which lends to property companies, and I do also own some holiday letting properties in Scotland. I actually wanted to ask you about the risk to financial stability, but I'm sure the chairman may do that if we've got time. But could I ask you about the government's measures affecting right to buy, which I suspect you may have covered in earlier discussion in the committee, whether you agree with these measures?
We've covered them probably. What do you think, chairman?
Can I ask my question about financial stability? To what extent do you think that the current housing market is a risk to financial stability? You've written quite a lot about this.
Yes. The answer is, fortunately, we do have a financial policy committee in the Bank of England that is devoting an immense amount of attention and thought to this question, which was not the case prior to the crisis. And the analyses seem to me to have been, as I would expect of the people involved, both on the committee and the staff, very professional. So, you know, our approach to this is orders of magnitude more professional than it was in the past. It is not, that's one. Two, my sense of it would be that events that would make our housing market a serious threat to British financial stability, banking stability, would be extreme. They would be very, very large events. Some combination of a giant recession with a very large fall in house prices, and the former would trigger the latter. That would be what would cause. We are quite well cushioned on the house price point, as my friend, the former governor of the Bank of England, used to point out. We were saved by our inability to build houses. So the chances of a big house price collapse, given that supply is continually growing more slowly than what appears to be demand, is not that high. And it would have to be a very, very big recession. Remember that the last recession, which was the deepest we've experienced since the interwar period, actually led to extraordinarily small losses on home mortgages, really small. So one of my favourite statistics, which you probably know, is that the British banks succeeded in losing more money on American mortgages than they lost on British mortgages. This would suggest to me that the financial risk from the British housing market, I leave aside commercial property, which is something else altogether, are modest and manageable barring some immensely significant world economic event, which is, I can give you scenarios, but they are not things that I would think sensible policymakers should plan for.
So you don't think there's a brief answer.
I agree with broadly with Martin. The only thing that area that I think is potentially a risk is, of course, London, where you're subject to international funding flows.
Yes.
But I think most lenders and the change the bank made is sufficiently apprised of the risk in London that no one is sufficiently exposed to London that it's likely to cause a risk to financial stability, although it could cause a nasty cold.
You don't think that a sudden rise in interest rates with high levels of mortgage borrowing and the effect on house prices could create a problem?
Well, it depends what... I mean, a sudden rise wouldn't be... I mean, the suddenness of the rise wouldn't matter, it's the level. If you're imagining a scenario, let me take an example, in which interest rates were to be 12%, I'm just an extreme, we would have a big problem. We would have a very big problem. Nothing's impossible. I mean, but these are very extreme scenarios. My impression, I've looked through this, if we're talking 4 or 5%, which would seem to me a reasonable extreme in the next cycle, though, wouldn't say. I don't think that will create any serious problems. But, of course, there are levels of interest rates at which we would have an enormous crisis. But we would have to imagine some immensely significant world event causing that. It's not impossible to do so when I look around at the world at the moment, but they would have to be very extreme events.
I think the alternative would be if we let inflation rip
and
nominal interest rates would have to increase... And then we'd have to cut back on public expenditure and the money supply and so on.
If the Bank of England lost control completely of inflation and we ended up with 10% inflation and the Bank of England had to raise rates to the sort of rates we saw in the early 80s with our current leverage, we would have a problem.
Yeah, or the mid-70s.
Yeah, but I mean, against...
Early 80s.
I don't disagree with that. I mean, obviously the last crisis was a real sort of financial stability crisis, but previously, clearly, in some sense, when you're raising rates, you're doing it to kind of slow the things down, the market down. It's hard to think of a circumstance in which you would have to raise rates so high that you really caused a housing market collapse. But I made the point earlier that one of the things that concerns me is that even in a moderate housing market collapse, we've removed so much support from people who have mortgages. And the second thing I would say is that the government's exposure to the housing market through some of the mortgage guarantee schemes is, of course, higher than it was generally.
Yes.
We have created some new
not
risks.
Yeah. And what was in my mind was that we seem to have got into a position where we're holding down interest rates, which is inflating asset prices, housing asset prices, and that you get into a cycle where it's very difficult to get out because of the level of gearing that has been attendant to that. And although the Bank of England has taken measures, it ought to be of concern, it seems to me.
Well, they are trying to offset... I assume this is not a discussion of monetary strategy, but I presume you will be talking to the Bank of England about this, but they are doing their best. It's a very interesting question whether sufficiently to control the leverage consequences in the housing market of their policies. Mm. And they would argue, I think with some plausibility, that the monetary policy's effect on the housing sector has not been that vast compared with some of the other asset markets that they are influencing. But that, again, we're not certain. There are risks here, but we are talking about, it does have to be a very, very large meltdown to start raising serious financial stability concerns given the current capitalization of the banking sector. I'm not saying it's impossible, but it would have to be quite extreme. And you have to then ask, well, how cautious should the central bank be in shielding us against risk?
I think that's right. I would say two things. One is that you've offered me the opportunity to make my favourite point about housing policy, which is that it is fatally unjoined up between bank, CLG, Treasury and DWP. It's already been apparent in my comments on mortgage support, but it's also kind of apparent in the drive for home ownership at one end of town and the drive to keep leverage down at the other end, which don't strike me as self-evidently compatible. Yeah. The second point I wanted to make is that you said that sort of leverage has been increasing. It's true that house prices have been rising, but net mortgage lending actually has not increased terribly much. So I don't think it's quite... I mean, I'm quite sure there are, as there always are, some people who are over-levered and struggling, but I think the effect of the mortgage market review has limited that very much. So I'm with Martin. I think that the market is, as a result of the FPC and the changes that have come in, that the market is more resilient. Sorry?
I mean, except with buy to let.
All the data show that the leverage of the household sector is currently below where it was before the crisis.
Yes. The
forecast from the OBR suggests that will reverse. So by the early 2020s, we might have reasons to be concerned about it, though the cushion from house prices is bigger. I just want to underline Kate's point, which is very important. A lot of the risk has been put on the Treasury's books, which seems to be completely appropriate since it's Treasury policy that is driving this, and that's where it should rest. I believe somebody will... My memory is that the buy-to-let was £120 billion, is that... Right, the help to buy was something like that. 120 billion. So that's what, 8% of GDP, something like that. So if it all went wrong, the whole lot landed on the Treasury, it would increase public sector debt, open debt, presumably, it's not going to, by 8 percentage points of GDP. I think that's roughly back then. So that would bring us up to 80, well, about 90. From where we are now, would that be a cause for a major run on the gilt market? And no, I mean you can ask whether it's a sensible use of the Treasury's borrowing power, but it's not going to bankrupt the Treasury. So it seems to me the risks are all manageable at the moment. These are famous last words. I'm aware of that.
I think, but to respond to the comment about buy-to-let, you're right. There is potentially a little bit more risk in the buy-to-let sector. And I think the bank would admit that they don't have such good evidence in the buy-to-let sector, the vulnerability of landlords. I think that's another reason why there's been a bit of pushing against buy-to-let. But this is really a question for the FPC, who have done much more work on this than we have.
Yes.
Okay. Lord de Mont.
I apologise for not being here at the beginning like Lord Forsyth. I was in the chamber. I think I came in when you were expressing your approval of the extra stamp duty on buy-to-let. But I'm old enough to remember when we wanted to encourage more investment in the rented sector, when the rented sector was much smaller than it is now. Hasn't buy-to-let actually increased very considerably the supply of rented accommodation? It is something that has acted on the supply side. And secondly, could I ask a question? I apologize if you have answered this before. It's very commonly argued that foreign buyers have very little to do with the market because it's very much a London phenomenon, which I accept. Though I must say I was a bit startled. I just went across the river the other day next to Battersea Power Station, so black block after block after block in which there was hardly a light on. It's difficult to believe this hasn't had actually quite a big impact in London and perhaps a ripple effect elsewhere. So really those are my two questions. Sorry?
They haven't finished building the houses, that's why there's no lights on.
Well, I did visit someone in one of the houses.
There are dark socks. I'm really bad at remembering questions. I can't now remember your...
Well, the first
was
just...
Yes, of course, the expansion of the buy-to-let sector has expanded the rented sector, but it's come along at the same time as the fall in home ownership. The question is, has the fact that buy-to-let landlords put money in helped to expand supply? And I think there the jury would have to be out. But it was rather like the comment about help to buy, it was a helpful source of demand in the early stages of the crisis. I think now, as we discussed earlier, the point that the kind of inequality of enabling people who've already got money to use it to put into a housing sector we push up because we don't build enough houses, it's such that my view is that what you're doing by taxing buy-to-let landlords a bit more is swinging the pendulum a little bit back in favour of first-time buyers in a more rational way than giving them subsidies, which just pushes up prices. There will, however, be an unintended consequence, which is that we will find some tenants have their tenancies terminated, and that will be
and there will be a difficult period of adjustment. I think we need to think about how we manage that.
I like buy-to-let for the reasons you've outlined, but it is more problematic if we can't actually increase overall supply. But I did think that the private rental sector was far too small. Mm. And a lot of people, particularly in London, are going to be here temporarily. They need flexible housing. This is exactly what we want. Furthermore, it makes a lot of sense for people to put money into housing as a form of pension, because there aren't that many other good assets. So, and it's perfectly reasonable. So there are lots of reasons why you want landlords. And so, I personally am close to neutral on tenure. We've had this discussion already. So the big issue is supply, overall supply. We wouldn't be worried about the tenure issue if we were dealing with supply. The second question you raise is one that is close to my heart. I have a sort of feeling, we never talked about reform of council tax, which is a horrendous system. But if we did what I would want, which is to have the council tax or some similar thing, obviously uprated to current circumstances, and continue to extend up the scale of home values up to 100 million plus at a reasonable rate, which is be higher than the current rate because it's ludicrously low, and it was doubled on empty properties, you would see this problem solved very, very quickly. And I own a little property in Italy as a foreigner. I pay a much higher tax than the domestic person does, and that seems to me, and I think that's absolutely and utterly reasonable.
Is it a significant factor?
You asked what I would do about empty properties. I have no idea about whether overall in London that would significantly affect.
I wasn't so much asking what you'd do about empty properties. It's just saying, you know, obviously there isn't a fixed supply of housing, but there's a very inelastic supply of housing. And you have this foreign demand. You know, we're taxing on buy-to-let one category of investors. It seems it might be argued it would make equal sense to, in a discriminatory way, tax foreign investors in property.
Some countries do. I don't know whether would this be legal under, I have no idea, EU law? Is it legal? The Italians do it, but then that's different. That's off the record.
I think there's considerable sympathy for that.
I have no problem with foreign buyers buying property. If they're either living there or renting it out. But I think there clearly is a problem where homes are being left empty and buildings are being left empty. And there I do see a potential role for tax along the lines that Martin suggests for having a role in that.
Can we come to one final intervention which has been made, and really which is inheritance tax, and it was touched upon earlier. But I'd like to couch it in a sort of rather more general question, which is that there have been a multitude of interventions, some small, some large, by governments over the last two decades to try and improve the supply of housing. One would have to say that they haven't been remarkably very successful. What, in your view, would be the interventions that you would recommend which you think might be successful?
We've talked about some of these on the way through. I've talked about a support for new towns. I've talked about a move to have a more sensible set of household numbers in the plans that would reflect incomes as well as household projections. And we've talked about the need to get smaller firms and self build back in, and I think all those would be very helpful. But the main thing that would make a difference would be if we had local politicians who had better incentives, as Martin said, to say to their populations, actually, it would be beneficial to us to have more people here. And until people accept that, it would be very, very difficult to push supply up.
Yeah, and have you have written about that and you recommended that. What has been the response?
We have seen, in terms of incentives, the new homes bonus. It hasn't yet proved to be a very efficient incentive. I would go further, in a sense, again, Martin hinted at this, and say that the people living in the town might pay a lower rate of, you know, might pay a lower rate of council tax. However, I have no illusions that in better off areas, these things often work better in poorer areas, it would necessarily have the effect, because I live in a town where quite a large sum of money was raised to fight an appeal, which suggested to me that the price for accepting the new houses was quite high.
I think the basic points have been made, and you need supply of land and housing permissions to build, which I think should be preemptive. I think the local authorities or the planning authority must have a strong incentive to do it, a reward for doing it. That can be done in a number of different ways. We've discussed several of them, through tax or through the essentially obtaining the gain. And I would just add one thing, which seems to me quite encouraging. Lord Turnbull has raised this. The changes that are now underfoot in the local government fiscal regime are potentially an environment within which it seems to me quite radical changes in the tax system and in the incentives for local authorities would be might reasonably be considered. And if they were we were to construct a regime in which local authorities could see themselves gaining substantially at a time when there is essentially no or limited support from the central government for their activities from development, we are more likely to see development than under any other sort of regime. So we have actually, I think, something of an opportunity. I always felt that taking the business rate away from local authority was a great mistake, and the council tax was inadequate, and maybe we could think about fiscal regimes which encourage local authorities to act preemptively to expand land available for building and to gain benefit for their residents on that basis. If we don't do that and do it quite aggressively, I don't think we're going to solve these problems at all. That's just a necessary condition. There are, of course, problems in the building industry, which we've discussed, but can I just comment very, very briefly on that, because they were at the beginning. I'm perfectly prepared to believe that right now, if we tried to create a regime in which we increased house building to 300,000, we couldn't do it. And it would probably take time. If we knew that that was what it was going to be, the industry would, of course, adapt. I mean, we fought a world war in 5 years. You can't tell me that we can't build a few houses in within 5 years if we really want to. It's a question of making it credible to the industry that that's what's going to happen. And there's no reason for them to believe it's credible, because no government has ever acted in a way to make it credible. So that's the problem. If you did, they would respond like any other business.
Mr. Walker.
Just picking up on a couple of those points, and I'd certainly concur that I think new towns and new cities is part of the answer. Obviously, there was the Wolfson Economics Prize, which looked at this issue. But more recently, I've explored the issue with Lord Matthew Taylor of Garden Villages, which is a system where you have locally derived new settlements, small new settlements through local consent. The problem, of course, with large-scale garden cities is that all too often they have to be imposed top-down, and you only have to look at problems like the Heathrow Third Runway to realise the political problems involved with that. So I think new settlements and doing new development in a different way in this country is really important. I also think devolution could be a really significant opportunity. So the devolution of stamp duty to London Mayor and to whoever the Mayor of the Northern Powerhouse will be, I think that could be a really opportunity in incentive space in terms of giving local areas more incentives to increase housing supply by being given control of their taxes. Just a couple of thoughts.
Lord Layard, do you want?
Yes, follows on from that very nicely, really. I mean, I must apologise to everybody that I haven't been able to be here, and maybe this has been covered, but from what I just picked up, would you agree that the shortage of housing land is a central reason for the shortage of housing?
Yes.
And for the high level of house prices? In which case, that is a central issue that has to be addressed. And can it be addressed without addressing the issue of building on greenfield sites, and in particular building on the sites where people want to build houses, which is actually on the edges of our great built-up areas. That is where people most want to build new houses, and where people most want to live. And is the way in which the built-up area has historically expanded over the last two centuries. But we now have a philosophy, apparently, which says that you mustn't expand an existing built-up area if you do anything new. It's got to be somewhere else. And I wonder if that makes sense, because, I mean, what people want, as we know, is green fingers. They don't want a green belt, which they don't visit. They want green near where they are, and there's no difficulty in expanding the existing built-up areas with green fingers left in amongst the expansion. So how do you respond to this picture of basically how we have to solve the housing problem by allowing our big built-up areas to expand into the greenery, green areas? Much of it is arable, not particularly valuable land, and the house price differential between the agricultural land and the building land is so extreme that there's clearly something weirdly inefficient about the allocation. So, do you see that as the way forward or not?
You're nicely dancing around avoiding using the words green belts, I notice, which is, of course, why. I think the green belt is a perfectly sensible policy because you don't want to have too much urban sprawl. I don't think anybody would wish to go back to the times when you had a lot of urban sprawl. I don't have a strong view. We've talked about new towns and new villages. I don't have a strong view as to anything being a silver bullet. One of the things that I sort of agree with Matthew Taylor on when he argues for garden villages is that the way in which we develop now, which tends to be little bits on the edge of towns, actually leads to a kind of suburbia which isn't necessarily all that pleasant to live in, even though quite a lot of people will live in it reasonably happily. And I'm more sympathetic to garden villages or really large urban or big urban extensions, you know, as was referred to by Christopher in the context of the Wolfson Prize. But I think we'll have to do stuff on the edge of towns as well. I think the idea that we can do it all through new stuff or old stuff or densification of old towns isn't right. But you can clearly densify quite a lot. You commented on things you'd seen in London. I was very startled the other day taking a bus down City Road to see how much flatted development had been built there, and clearly London is going to end up as a denser city, and we will then at some point have to answer the question as to whether we want to have a dense London city, or we want to have a slightly bigger London with transport, or we want to have bigger towns in places like Hertfordshire with good transport in. If we don't answer these questions terribly well, and the removal of the regional tier of government means sadly we answer them even more badly.
My word on the green belt is that prejudice is the answer.
I know. But if you don't say it, you're not being really very honest about the answer you're giving. You have to be prepared.
Either of you want to comment?
Well, I've written about this, so I've never been. I exist to make Kate sound reasonable, as she pointed out. I've never seen the point of the green belt. My answer to this is, if we had a green belt policy in 1850, we wouldn't have London. And I find London infinitely more interesting than the alternative, and interesting, more enjoyable, and retrospectively. I don't think, would we really want to put back all the green fields we swallowed up in the process? I don't think so. We've got plenty of them. Most of the country is fields, most of them not particularly beautiful, as Lord Laird said. So I think it is clear that part of the solution is
to allow some building in the green belt. It's a necessary part. It's probably not the whole solution. And a great deal of it around London is really not very distinguished or very usable. We've got us this sort of view it as almost sacred. I find it very, very puzzling. And so I think this is something that does have to be opened up. However, I do understand that as soon as this is put forward, a vast number of people and organisations, which I don't need to mention by name, will get absolutely hysterical about the desecration of the English countryside and the terrible consequences thereof. But I do think we have a fundamental problem. We have a country with a growing population and a growing economy, both as a result of forces we can't control, some of them very desirable. And the consequence of that is that the demand for housing, including space in housing, is going to rise, and it will have to be satisfied somehow. And some of that is going to include making our big cities bigger. London, by the way, right now is one of the world's smaller big cities. Come from, not that I'm recommending China as the model. So we can expand London, and it will be absolutely wonderful if we do it in the right way.
Right. Mr. Walker, would you like to add
anything? There's a great map that shows cities expanding and London not expanding. I'd like just a historical footnote. The first green belt was introduced by Elizabeth I, but sensibly it was then expanded.
Mr. Walker, would you like to add anything?
Just very quickly, I mean, you know, we're going to have to build up, or we're going to have to build out, and we're probably going to need some combination of both. I agree that there is no silver bullet. I think absolutely we need to have a sensible debate about the green belt. Most of it isn't green. Most of it is brown. And I'll just finish with a statistic that if we built on 10% of the green belt inside the M25, we could build 1 million homes on it. So it's worth thinking about.
One of the things people don't understand is how much an extra mile on London adds to the area of London. It's enormous. Yeah. And you have to remember that it doesn't require very much to build a lot of housing.
Look, thank you very much indeed. It was a very stimulating discussion, and it's got us off to a very lively start in our inquiry. So thank you very much for being
pleasure.
With us today.
Thank you.
What's a nice number?
Now you can talk
to it.
Sound. Committee Room 1, sound. Committee Room 1, sound.